intersected. of the river. Each evening, the sun disappeared in the west as if it had been swallowed by the sky. But during the night, it was regenerated and appeared again the next day on the eastern horizon. From the earliest of times, the Egyptians used these simple natural observations to develop a vision of the world based on the terrestrial north-south and celestial east-west axes, which formed the foundation of their religious beliefs. Curiously, as vital as the Nile was to their very existence, despite the part it played in their vision of the world, the Egyptians never defied it. Deified it. I was wondering what that meant. The Egyptians never deified it, associating with divinities not the river itself, but rather its effects. Thus, they identified Hapi, a god associated of abundance, with the phenomena of the Nile flood, and similarly the energy of the waters that revitalized and fertilized the land, was associated with the resurrection myth of Osiris. Hence, the correlation between the cult of the dead, the concept of divine resurrection, and the fertilization of the land was probably developed as early as the pre-dynastic period, which we learned last time was, it's very, very, very handy right here. We have the entire chronology, which was 4000 to 3000 BC. Scorpion King reigned during this period, and it must have taken a seriously warlike yet benevolent enough individual to dominate and become a leader, yet respected enough to develop a communal consensus from which entire organizations and structures of society that make society tick could work in effort and concert. They needed builders, metallurgists, blacksmiths. Farmers, they needed priests back then, who all the way until the Middle Ages were conjoined with the duties of both religious mystic and fortune teller and wise counsel, as well as more practical counsel, such as the seasons and seasonal floodings that could be timed just perfectly, and predicted, and around which you would have an entire civilization bearing, reaping the benefits of the crop that the land bared, granted that it was planted at the exact right time that their celestial calendar indicated. So I think it's so fascinating, like, what type of people must have emerged out of the nomadic desert existence, or as there are plenty of evidence that in around the Sphinx, for example, it might have rained for thousands of years and been almost a tropical climate, at some points, because there is significant weathering of water erosion that isn't around the Sphinx, that isn't consistent. If I could find it with Nile floods. In fact, it's a geologist, Robert Schock's opinion, that, let's look up the Sphinx here. It's very reminiscent of my Atlas video with three great artists, ASM Arctica, Gaslamp, and Tingles with Flyby, by the way, where we all looked up different queries that we challenged each other to. But if you guys want to check it out, that's on ASM Arctica's amazing, amazing channel, if you haven't heard of them. But here we have the Sphinx, page 5, 39 and 47. Let's go to 39. Let's see real quick. There we go. And 47. Yeah. Well, I'll go into that later. I always mention it and never actually go very, very far into it. But, man, the origins of this civilization, this great civilization, is so intriguing. It really is so interesting. Sorry if I'm getting excited. I need to keep it calm, keep it cool, because I want you guys to relax and wake up for school. And I want to get to the point where you drool on your pillow so I can sit with you guys and be mellow. Alright, that's enough of that. That's as far as I can go with that one. But I want you guys to think I'm a kind fellow. And everything will be good. You, God, I'm so dumb sometimes. So where were we? They identified Hopi, which, so they didn't directly associate the Nile as a god, but rather some primordial material out of which lands and gods themselves were kind of created, and it was associated with the resurrection myth of Osiris. So let's catch up. So the Nile was such a part of their landscape that perhaps it was like the air we breathe. We are so intimately, closely connected with it that we don't notice it. We only notice its effects. Some things we call wind when it's powerful, or frost when it's cold and condenses, or rain when the wind precipitates into water droplets and fall from the sky, which I don't think these guys really ever saw, especially later in their history. But hence the correlation between the cult of the dead, the concept of divine resurrection, and the fertilization of the land that was probably developed as early as the pre-dynastic period. Okay, that's where we were. The Egyptians believed that the Nile flowed from a cavern fed by a subterranean ocean of Nun. It composed itself composed of the primordial waters from which the universe was created, and on which the world floated. They thought that the great river flowed uninterruptedly towards the very waters that fed it, and returned to also believed that the sun god Atum-Ra, creator of all things, rose out of the primordial ocean noon. The sun, in turn, created two deities, Tifnut, the damp air, and Shu, the dry air. Pantheon itself was structured according to a religious or rigidly hierarchy. From the gods to the pharaoh through to the people subdivided into classes. The gods personified the forces of nature supervising every event and every activity. They were responsible for the destiny of the country and every inhabitant of it. The cults of various gods were the responsibility of the pharaoh and the priests who provided for the terrestrial needs of each deity and the care of their material images according to extremely complex rituals. The people instead venerated their gods in small tabernacles and shrines constructed in the villages and the countryside. Moreover, each region, district, and settlement had its own god. Of course, that makes sense, right? Its own myths, which were accepted with absolute tolerance by the official clergy. And that's, I guess, what I would mean by the benevolence. So you must be a powerful, violent individual to reach the top of the pinnacle of your hierarchy, especially around and among all these desert Nile-dwelling tribes. If two political individuals with only two-thirds your power team up together because of your tyrannical, unempathetic, unjust ruling. So you see, you must have the, really just the whole package. You must be very competent physically, intellectually. You must have a lot of guile enough to win wars. You must have enough gall to lead an army and gain their respect on the battlefield. Yet simultaneously, you must have enough wisdom and compassion to do such things as accept with absolute tolerance each region, district, and settlement's own gods and their own myths, which, interestingly enough, apparently all coalesced into an overall religious phenomenon that we know today as ancient Egyptian religion. So it's interesting that they can assimilate. Maybe they separated the wheat from the chaff and were able to separate and only assimilate the most beneficial, well, wise aspects of these local myths and gods. So the minor deity is actually the most important in terms of popular religion. Manifested themselves in multiple forms and took diverse names from place to place, to place to place, to place to place, all up and down. From the south in the upper Egypt to the north in placed in special necropolises after their deaths. Necro being the prefix for death. I would love to see a mummified crocodile. Jesus, that would be cool. I'm sure they were much bigger back then too. Or at least more numerous, if anything. So, among the gods worshipped throughout Egypt were Osiris, the lord of the underworld, portrayed in the form of a mummy with a bluish, you can see here, flesh tone. His wife Isis, a witch and powerful goddess of life and regeneration. And of course the jackal-headed Anubis. The god of the necropolises and patron of mummification, and Bes, depicted as a dwarf with monstrous features, the protector of pregnant women and god of the family. Among the secondary deities most frequently encountered in Egyptian iconography, are Mat, the goddess of justice, represented with a feather on her head, and Gum, the god who modeled man on his potter's wheel, represented with a ram's head, and then Seth, which, as far as I understand, is the origin of the word Satan. Seth becomes Set, becomes Satan, the god of negativity and destruction, represented with the head of an unidentified animal. Then Hathor, the goddess of love, the music, and the arts, represented with the ears of a cow, the Egyptian analog of avatar of Dionysus. Bacchus, the god of wine and art and passion. And then Bastet, the beneficent goddess and protector of births, represented by the head of a cat. And then Thot, the god of writing and notary to the gods, represented with the head of an ibis. And Sobek, a god who protected the waters from enemies, represented with the head of, you guessed it, a crocodile. And lastly, the deities venerated above all at Thebes were the triad composed of Amun-Ra, king of the gods, the Zeus of Egypt, and the solar deity Mut, his wife, and Khonsu, their son, and the god of the moon. And here we have a statue of the goddess Sekhmet in gilded wood, found in the tomb of Tutankhamun. Wow, look at that. I think that's so realistic. It's like a lion's face. That's incredible. Sekhmet. And then the also part of Tutankhamun's funerary goods, these necklace, the golden counterpiece of semi-precious stones, and vitreous paste features, some figures representing eternity. And down here in the foreground, the blue one, also they just cleverly superimposed these images. We see detail of a pectoral depicting of the goddess Nut in gold, cornelian and vitreous paste. The jewel of this solid gold. Okay, so we'll go and return to the details of their cult of the dead in our next Egyptian episode. And as you can see, this book is only 180 pages or so, but it's so full of fantastic high def unique pictures. I really just honestly want to probably have a whole episode where I just casually browse and read the image figure descriptions, because of course reading it would take a while. Look at that. But there's so much history that I just wasn't aware of. And that aerial view right there is just beautiful. Beautiful, absolutely beautiful. So, and while I'm talking about being inspired, Milena, thank you so much for your donation. I actually wasn't gonna make a video tonight, and I got the notification of your donation on PayPal, so I don't know, it just inspires me to make stuff that I would personally like to fall asleep to, and it's so exciting. It's really humbling that you guys enjoy the same stuff I do, and it's, I don't know, it's like a, I don't want to sound dramatic, but it's like a connecting with good people, you know? So, I don't know. Thank you, Milena. Or is it Milena? I hope it's Milena, because that's what I started with. And also, Tim, Steve, you know who you are. Jody, Tristan, thank you guys. And Ryan and Sandy, you've all been a big part in helping this channel grow. So, those are my PayPal supporters and the continual supporters on Patreon. That's a whole nother list, and I really just am so grateful to Potato Launch, Hard Yakka, and Scrappy, and Cameron, Simon Smith, Ayla Gregory, thank you guys, and Kieran and Sean, you guys are so awesome. You've been with me for a while. It's, I don't know, I'm just very grateful that you guys are showing me the love that you do. That's serious love, thank you. And Antoine and Eric C, man, you guys are really helping me out. Thank you. And Debbie C, Mark, Matthias, Joshua and Andy, thank you. Just keep me pumped. I don't know. You really do. And Dale, you're new. I want to really give you a special thank you as well. And the last but absolutely not least is Dylan and Alexander. You guys, your support means so much. And I hope, you know, these measly little shout-outs something to make you feel that you're appreciated, because you really are. All you guys are. Until next time, I wish you a comfortable, deep, satisfying sleep and a refreshing and positive start to your day tomorrow. Go get some and go get it tomorrow, guys. You're the best.